friends say, man, you're a quote unquote friend of sinners. And I was like, I was like, man, interesting, you know?
That's funny. It's
the title that Jesus was, you know what I'm saying? A friend of sinners.
Hello and welcome to the Jude 3 Project's new series, From People to Person, sponsored by the Matthew 5-9 Fellowship. My name is Brandon Cleaver, and I serve as a Matthew 5-9 Outreach Manager. We're a group of pastors and Christian leaders shepherding our communities to live out the gospel and place our identities in Christ above partisanship and societal divisions. We support both pastors and Christian leaders with resources and training to grapple with the harmful divisions in the U.S. in hopes of building a future in which all human beings are treated as image bearers of God, regardless of earthly divisions. With the unfortunate and pervasive co-opting of our Christian identity for political gain, it's up to us to lead with integrity so that others know what it means to be Christian. Oftentimes, that entails conversations just like these, where we don't necessarily endorse everything that's espoused, but we do endorse the idea of listening to those whom we may disagree with. And this is what healthy conversation and deep relationships are about too, creating space to be Christian when it counts. From People to Person is a series of conversations that seeks to cherish the individual. We understand that all religious groups have a core set of beliefs, but moving from people to person means that we're moving from these broad generalizations to specific engagements. Just as individuals in Christianity express their faith differently, nuances also exist within other religious groups. The Jude 3 Project has produced an abundance of informative interviews, series on various topics, blogs, and other resources that explicitly address the current issues and intellectual struggles of Christians of African descent. The goal in this series, From People to Person, is not to give immediate answers, but to cultivate genuine understanding. In this three-part series, Lisa will sit down with guests from various faith backgrounds to listen to their faith journeys. Both the Jude 3 Project and Matthew 5-9 Fellowship hopes that these conversations encourage not only civility, but lasting change.
What's up, everybody? We're back from People to Person. This time we have both of our panelists with us. We have Street Hymns and Sistar joining us back. I know y'all have enjoyed their conversation individually. The reason I found out about them together was because they have a battle rap. I had met Street Hymns at an event in Cali, and he was telling me about a battle rap he had coming up. And I was like, do y'all like talk outside of the battle? Like, I was like, I know y'all battling, and he was talking about the different theologies and beliefs. And
we trash talked beforehand.
Yeah. Yeah. It was a nice
meeting. It wasn't like trash talk.
Yeah,
it was just like...
this was the most interesting trash talk I've done leading to a battle. Like, it was like, I'm not going to say borderline cheesy, but it wasn't. Like, we were competing on doing stuff in the community and stuff like that. Like, just being different. Yeah. Like, it was definitely an enjoyable experience.
Yeah. So I was like, do y'all talk? Because, you know, I'm big on conversations, more conversations, less debates. And so I was like, I understand battle rap culture obviously is kind of the debate. Mm-hmm. But I was like, do y'all actually sit down and just talk about like the differences? And he was like, well, not really. But he did say y'all had got an opportunity to chat after kind of build relationship. So I thought it'd be good to bring y'all on. I know y'all talked. But when I asked him about talking, I was like, on camera. And he was like, oh, that'd be dope.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Here we are.
Yeah,
thank you for having me.
Yeah. So y'all did a battle. How was that?
It was great.
Yeah.
It was great.
It's definitely one that... due to like from public opinion, it's definitely a classic, you know. Mm-hmm. So I love being able to go on to battles, finish battles, and then there isn't really like anybody cares that there's a winner or loser.
Yeah, they're really not talking about that.
Yeah,
they love the back and forth and the routes that we took in the battle with our content. Yeah. So yeah, that makes it a very purposeful, you know.
Now, I know y'all battle was about kind of y'all beliefs at some parts of it. not the whole thing, but y'all did have moments where y'all had different ideologies and beliefs. How did that go?
Yeah, so for me personally, from the aspect of beliefs, I didn't have a personal conversation with her, so I didn't even want to like assume beliefs per se, mm-hmm. but based off of her audience and then some of the things that she would say publicly, I was like, okay, cool.
It might be that battle.
Yeah, it was that.
It might be that battle.
Like, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So for me, I kind of took a generalization of, you know, a culture, and then from that addressed beliefs of the culture. But it really wasn't like intended to be, hey, everyone, by the way, she believes this, 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 and this. Kind of like what people do with like even battling Christians. Mm-hmm. You know, like it's not really you're sitting there battling that person per se. You're either mad at God or arguing with God or, you know, portraying things. And so I was like, okay, what does that look like on the other front of that? Because typically Christian battle rappers are always on the defense. And I was like, what would it be to actually flip that role real quick, you know? And so my purpose was like more so flip the role and then give people something to talk about afterwards, you know, and just put information that people probably weren't even aware of or just some conversation starter. So for me, it wasn't solely on beliefs, but more so the system. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah. What are your thoughts on that?
I think that it definitely was still a conversation, but maybe not the conversation people expected us to have. Because they expected us to just go back and forth and talk about Christianity and Kemet or whatever and just kind of do that. And I took a different route. Mm-hmm. In my spirit, like when I just saw his name, Street Hymns, I wanted to tell some of my street hymns. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to, and what I did was, I gave examples of lessons that I learned and how that's spiritual for me in the midst of my street hymns. And I talked about the system and some problems.
It's fire.
What he did was fire, too. He has a phenomenal flow, too. Like, it was great. But and I talked about some of the systematic issues that we're having in the Black community that leads to some of the problems and things that I've experienced. And then, so I took that and then made it to the goal of we shouldn't be conflicted. You know, like we need to be looking at our likeliness because I'm so tired of war. So that was like, that was my goal. And I knew he wasn't gonna expect that.
What was the joint? There's a difference between reading the book and
I said, this is not faith in spirit versus seeing them. This is those just living life, leaving books behind versus those just reading them.
Just reading them. I was like, that was fire. Okay, I was like, indeed. Cause I could tell like it was more so tracing into the source of like, yo, which I got from that was, don't just make all truth come from one source. Is that what you were saying?
Yeah, don't just make all truth come from what people told you to read.
Okay,
you know?
For sure.
Live your life and learn the lessons. And like you talk about a lot, application. You know, and through application, you create your own parables. And that, to me, is spirituality. So that was what that was about. And then I dropped the book, too. So it was like, it was a double, like,
yeah. Indeed. Okay. Yeah. By the way, purchase my book. Yeah. Indeed. Fire.
So,
fire.
Yeah.
Did you learn anything from Street Hymns, from relationship with him, a conversation after, about things he was passionate about, his beliefs, and vice versa?
Yeah, that was my first time meeting someone and them explaining to me the difference between being Hebrew and being a Hebrew Israelite. Like, because as soon as he said Hebrew, like he said in his interview, your mind strictly goes there, you know? So that's where my mind went, and he was, like, explaining it to me. And we had a really good conversation. and was able to come to certain understandings. And I like that he's so intelligent mm-hmm. and so vast and not in a box, because the terms that he utilizes and the way that we're able to communicate, not in anger or emotion, but openly and understandingly, we were breaking down certain terms mm-hmm. and how certain terms you look at differently. Mm-hmm. And that creates the conversation. Mm-hmm. You know, and people have to learn how to communicate in that way, because people speak different spiritual languages. You could be talking about the same thing and don't even know it mm-hmm. because of what your data is programmed to think when you hear a certain word. And now you way over there when really y'all was right here, mm-hmm. you know. So I appreciated that with him, because I haven't been able to do that with too many people. Mm-hmm. You know, like most people are just like, and it's like, so it puts you on. But we were like
flowing.
Yeah, and learning and just creating an understanding. So I appreciated that with him, that exchange.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, vice versa, I guess it was in related to what I would call the divine counsel. And because one thing that I was interested in, she did a battle, another classic, with the dude named B-Dot. And B-Dot is another spiritual brother within the battle rap community, conscious. One of the guys who's literally one of the top guys, the competitors within the culture right now. Him and Loso actually have a great battle as well. Shout out to the Four Horsemen. but I heard you call or address a deity as the Most High Nthu, right? Mm-hmm. I say it right.
But yeah, okay. Yeah, that was good. You did good.
So I was like, okay, when I say Most High, I'm referring to Yahweh. And I was asking her, when you're using the term Most High, is this a person? Is it a being? Is it a deity? And so we basically had the discussion of what does that mean? Mm-hmm. You know, who is this? What it may be. And of course, you know, for me, it's Yahweh, you know, the Most High. And from what I got, it was the embodiment of all things unified, right? So yeah, that's kind of, and so yeah, we kind of just were discussing on that term. So because I didn't know, because like when I hear that, I'm like, oh, there's a deity she worships, right? You know, amongst others. Right, because when I was researching things in Kemet and things, I'm like, okay, so you have this god, this god, this goddess, that goddess. And I'm like, okay. And then understanding that there are those in the Kemetic community who do individually worship certain deities or pray, but then there's others who just understand them to be concepts, mm-hmm. you know, and then apply the concepts in the natural realm. So even me learning not to generalize mm-hmm. the culture, you know. So it was dope. The conversation was definitely fruitful, just to understand different types of perspectives, even within a camp, community, or group.
Yeah, that's extremely helpful, I think, for all of us to understand. Because, you know, with Jew3 Project, we have kind of scholars that speak on different groups. And oftentimes when you're giving points to a group, there's not a lot of nuance sometimes on the spectrum within the group. And so you go into a conversation saying, this person believes this, this person believes that. And if I don't actively listen, I can put stuff on a person that's not there. And so what it seems like what you're saying and what you're saying is like, both in conversation, interaction, battle rap, conversation afterwards, y'all got to see, okay, I know what this group claims to believe generally, but as I talk to you, I see like there's some differences and I need to address the differences and see you as a person. Because I think that's humanizing a person yeah. when I see them pass just some facts I learned about a group.
Yeah, and that is hip hop in itself. Hip hop knowledge was always a pillar of hip hop. You know, that's the K in the smack URL, it's knowledge. And so, when you see the battle, it's easy to get lost in the aggression and the vulgarities and the threats and things like this. but the culture outside of it, the discussions that are happening behind closed doors at the dinner table.
It's very fruitful.
You know what I'm saying? It's literally fruitful.
Fulfilling.
Exactly. And these are people who literally got to scream at each other's necks right before, you know? So it's a very family oriented culture.
Definitely. That's what I was about to say. It's exactly what it feels like. Like every event feels like a family reunion. Mm-hmm. You know, like the barbecue. Like, that's what it feels like. And it's so many intelligent people in the battle rap community. And I don't think people understand how intelligent they have to be to continuously create what they create. And you have to even have a certain level of health, you know, for your mind to work a certain way, for your body to be able to, the breath control and the everything. Like, it's a lot that comes with that people are not knowing of. And the parking lot conversations will shock you.
I think that's helpful to know. I think I should have started here, but I think this will be helpful for our audience now. What is battle rap culture? Because I think we're talking about it and people don't know.
It varies.
Like battle rap.
Yeah. It definitely
like, what
varies.
Is it? What is battle rap? Like, I didn't even know that was a thing.
Indeed.
It definitely Indeed. Is its own element of hip hop now. It is an evolution of its original state. Because, you know, originally battle rap, they got mics or you over beats, yeah, anywhere, you at the park, on the corner, whatever, and it's freestyle. Well, in the YouTube era, it became more written. I mean, people do still freestyle, but it's set up more like, almost like boxing matches. Mm. You know your opponent ahead of time, you study game tapes, and you prepare, because this is gonna live forever. Mm-hmm. And because of that, it made people more intellectually write and take the writing more serious. Some of the best writers in the world are battle rappers.
That's true.
Because they had to learn the science of writing. Mm-hmm. You had to get intricate. You had to learn assemblies and metaphors and double, triple, quadruple entendres and schemes and all of these things while still the fundamental of rap. Mm-hmm. And it fused, in a sense, in its evolution process with comedy, with theater, with spoken word, and it became its own thing. And brings a vast fan base because of that, because people like different things, and it's there.
You gotta keynote that part. That was a perfect explanation of battle rap. That was legit. Like, I would just clip that, because that's great. That was perfect. That's it.
So I think this has been rich conversations we've had today individually. The church struggles with having these conversations, because oftentimes when you're in a Christian, you get in a bubble and you're not forced outside of going to work to have conversations with people that think differently. However, y'all in the battle rap culture, from what I'm understanding and gathering from the community and y'all explaining the community, you're constantly engaged in people with people who have different beliefs. And you describe it as a family. And that's hard for people to see, because they go to Thanksgiving and they're like, we don't even bring up our different beliefs, because that'll ruin Thanksgiving. Yeah. And so y'all live in a community where y'all have different beliefs, but y'all still have a family kind of vibe. So how do you do that? Because I think that's helpful.
That's
to
a
know.
Good question. Just you asking, how do we do that? In the battle rap community, first and foremost, most of us have been around for years. So you get the opportunity to see people grow, see people develop, see people go through stuff. And when you become a person that's experiencing these people going through these processes, you become more open to the differences, you know? And I think what we need to like try to stick to as people in communicating is listening, not with the thought to judge and not with the thought to see the differences, but to see the likeliness. And it's the likeliness that makes us a family. Mm-hmm.
That's good.
Absolutely. Yeah, I would definitely agree. My biggest message I would relate to the church, it was interesting. It shocked me to hear one of my friends say, man, you're a quote-unquote friend of sinners. And I was like, I was like, man, interesting, you know?
That's and
it's
funny.
It's the title that Jesus was, you know what I'm saying? A friend of sinners. And I was like, man, like, how is that not normal then? You know, it's like, well, most people that are in church, most Christians, only hang out with Christians, only group up with other Christians and believers. And I definitely see the logic behind it, but if we are the ecclesia, we are called to go out, you know? And so for me, my message to any group of persons or people, whether it's battle rap or whether it's modeling, whether it's social media, never judge a culture from the outside, because you'll never understand it. You know, it's literally like going into somebody's household and telling them how to raise their kids. It's like you have no idea what goes on behind these doors. All you're seeing is an interaction right here. And what audacity do you have to even come in and tell me how to do things? In the same way, it's a culture. It's like, yo, we've developed a family. We've developed a culture here. And so when you're judging it from the outside, until you actually go and sympathize, empathize, cry, laugh, you know what I'm saying, sharing the joy with the people, you'll never understand it. And so for me, my message to the church would be, you know, to broaden the horizon of what you consider to be ministry and evangelism. You know, we can do more than just make posts on social media. We can actually go out and engage with people, meet them where they're at, have the conversations with the intent of listening and desiring to understand, like, man, like, not so much, oh, you believe something different. It's like, well, there's a reason you believe that. Mm-hmm. There's a cause and effect, you know? And I would like to know the cause and effect, because if you believe that, that means there's a million other yous that might believe the same thing. Mm-hmm. And so if that's the case, then we have to be able to be sensitive enough to understand that if there are a massive group of people believing in something, then we should be privy and studying up on what's going on, the why, the how, and how much like that we are as well, so we can relate, becoming all things to all men. You know, so I believe battle rap is a beautiful culture, and as challenging as it is, as vulgar as it is, as intense as it is, it's that much more on the other end, community as well.
That's dope. I think that's a good place to end it. I'm so glad you all joined me. Y'all came from far, Texas and LA.
Yeah.
To sit here and chill, to talk about from people to person. I think this is going to be rich for our audience. And remember, we're having more conversations, less debates. And it's not about talking about, but it's about talking to. Until next time, grace and peace, and God bless. Woo!